So we've seen that natural selection can shape life histories, and that lifespan can in fact be an adaptive trait, whether to live longer or instead to invest relatively more in reproduction. And fundamental to this concept is the idea of antagonistic pleiotropy. And this is that there may be certain genes that are favored by natural selection because they enhance reproduction, but those same genes have an additional effect, a pleiotropic effect. They have side effects that reduce our survival. How might genes enhance reproduction, yet reduce survival? Well, let's look at testosterone. Testosterone is a very important hormone in males. Testosterone promotes muscle growth, beards, large voice boxes. But testosterone has a harmful effect on our immune system. Having muscles and beards and large voice boxes may impress the ladies, but at the same time, the trait harms the immune system. So we have the likelihood of a trait that can really enhance attractiveness, reproductive success, particularly in younger individuals. And these sorts of traits will be especially likely to evolve if the side effects that they produce are not actually felt until the man is older. Let's think about this. We've seen this before. We have extrinsic mortality in the age structure of a population. We have lots of 10-year-olds, but because of predation and fighting or whatever else, there may be very few left by the age of 50 or 60. Now, if we have a trait like testosterone that enhances male reproduction in his 20s, okay, there's a lot of individuals that will benefit from that in the population. And if the costs of testosterone are not really felt until men are in their 60s, very few left will pay those costs. Okay? So many more of the population will receive the benefits than will suffer from the costs. These trade-offs may be especially important if the costs are delayed, but we can also see these trade-offs even in the absence of a delay, even if the costs are felt at the same time as the advantages. So here we see a mating pair of lions who are rather foolishly ignoring the risk of being trampled by an elephant. So even at the time of their reproduction, they're still suffering a higher cost to their potential survival. And we can see this direct trade-off in fruit flies. This is a study of Drosophila melanogaster, and this is a survival curve which we've seen before. And we start out with everybody being alive at a certain age. And now what we're going to do is have male Drosophila who are exposed to different levels of reproduction. Okay, if we have some male Drosophila that are leading a monastic life, okay, so they're kept in a jar with no females, there's just males there and no females, then the risk of dying is very low. So we still have 80% alive after 3 weeks, and everybody, there's still about 75% alive after about 50 days. But if we allow them to mate, so we have males in with females, there are fewer and fewer still alive, and they're dying off like flies. So that nobody who's been allowed to mate with females lives longer than 40 days. If we take the males out of their monastery and allow them to start mating, then they start dying. So even though their mortality rate was very low, once they start breeding with females, then they start dying like flies again. And if we take these playboy flies and protect them from the costs of further mating, they stop dying and their survival is really okay. Okay, so they're making a direct trade-off between reproduction and survival. And in flies, this is obvious because there's only a certain amount of protein reserves available to each male. And every time a male mates, he transfers some of that protein in the form of sperm to the female. So he's inevitably killing himself by inseminating the female. Ah, there he is in the death act. There are also very clear examples of suicidal trade-offs between survival and reproduction in mammals. Here is Antechinus stuartii, known as the marsupial mouse. So this thing looks like a mouse, but it's actually related to the possum. It's quite small. The females live about 2 years, and they have a litter of almost 7 babies. Okay? During the rut each year, there's incredible competition between the males for access to mate with these females. The males fight like crazy. They'll bite anything that moves. And after 11 days, they're worn out. And within 2 days after that, every male drops dead of old age. They die of old age because they have generated a lethal cocktail of testosterone and stress hormones that literally wears out their physiology. So the costs of reproduction there are totally suicidal. Now, in humans, you might be surprised to learn that sex is inherently costly as well. Remarkably, there are data suggesting that boys who've been castrated, like in the old days, there were castrati in choirs like Farinelli. And if young men are castrated, their life expectancy was actually 14 years longer than that of intact men. In women, if girls are ovaryectomized, that increases their life expectancy by about 12 years as well. So there's an inevitable trade-off between survival and reproduction. And in this case, the trade-off is because the sex hormones appear to interfere with our immune response. If we have our gonads, then we're much more likely to suffer from infectious diseases. So, we have antagonistic pleiotropy, where genes enhance reproduction but reduce survival. These are especially likely to spread if they favor reproduction in the young and are harmless in old age, since so few individuals will still be alive to suffer the costs. The second theory of evolution of aging is called mutation accumulation. In this case, there's no advantage to these genes at all. It's just simply that there's so few individuals still alive at old age that selection is too weak to weed out these mutations if they only harm older individuals. So here we're going to have our age structure again. And let's look at two alternative mutations. On the left, we have a mutation, a rare mutation, that it kills 50% of children. Okay? On the right, we have a mutation that doesn't do anything to young people. It's harmless, 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 but it's inevitably fatal to old people. So, which of these two genes is more likely to persist in a population? The one that is harmful for children, or one that is only harmful for very old individuals? Which would be removed most quickly by natural selection? Well, if a mutation only kills the elderly, most carriers will have already had their children and died from other cause, so the mutation cannot be eliminated. So a lot of these others might carry the same mutation, but they died from other causes, so the genes are now safely in the next generation. And only a few unfortunate individuals who actually had the good luck to live to an advanced age will suffer from these mutations. And we see that indeed genes that do have a greater impact on children tend to be rare compared to those that are only harmful in older people. So for example, the gene frequency of the allele associated with Alzheimer's, a form of dementia, is 60 times more common in the population than the allele that causes cystic fibrosis and much, much mortality in children. So to summarize these two ideas, with antagonistic pleiotropy, we're thinking about how natural selection can favor genes that confer youthful vigor despite side effects at advanced ages. With mutation accumulation, we're realizing that selection cannot remove purely harmful mutations that only hurt the elderly because so few individuals are still alive to suffer those costs.